Welcome to the Civil War Digital Digest. I'm your host, Felicia, and today I'm here with Mike Wosher, an expert on India rubber and gutta percha, really throughout history, but today we're here to talk about during the Civil War time period.
Right.
He also authored his book, you can see it here on the table, but today we're going to talk about the overview of just what is rubber during this time and where did it come from. So, Mike, what is rubber?
I think we can start maybe a little earlier in American history, in the pretty much in the 1500s and 1600s. We have a lot of notations made in letters and diaries of the Spanish military noting natives in South America and Haiti using basically two applications, rubber balls and also for clothing, to waterproof clothing.
Okay.
But they also noted something that would haunt inventors who were trying to utilize rubber for specific applications. They noted that the garments were melting in the rays of the sun. So right away, they found that this latex that came out of the tree can waterproof things, but it was susceptible to temperature changes. Basically, that it was hot in the summer, hot and sticky in the summer, and in the winter it got cold and brittle. So
where did it get its name, rubber?
Oh, okay, good question. In the 1770s, one of the earliest noted applications in Europe was a mathematician, instrument dealer, and stationer by the name of Mr. Nairn in London was selling half-inch squares of this gum material to rub out lead pencil marks.
Oh.
So, like an eraser. And
yeah.
We find, jumping ahead just a little bit, in this Civil War ditty bag, we find a wooden inkwell, and we also find a square of hardened rubber, which was used as an eraser. So,
okay.
So it was also known, I think we need to mention too, the fact that it's called India rubber throughout the rest of the 1770s and into all the way through the 1800s, because one of two reasons. People thought that the material came from India, or they were referencing the fact that it was harvested by Indians in South America, where most of the rubber was coming from, so it was noted India rubber. But it was also referred to at that time as caoutchouc, which is a French derivative for gum of the tree. It was called vegetable leather. It was called gum elastic. So there was a lot of different references to rubber.
Okay, so it goes by a lot of names throughout time.
But India rubber in the Civil War period is what you see predominantly referenced. Yeah.
Okay, so how do we get from this whole idea of erasers to some of the really awesome things we're seeing in front of us?
Okay, yeah. In the late 1700s and early 1800s, a lot of people were trying to develop a cure to this instability of rubber, so none of them were effective. In the early 1820s, a gentleman by the name of Charles McIntosh in England developed a process using naphtha where he could coat materials and garments, and it was pretty stable in the British climate, okay? And his name was Charles McIntosh. So the coats became known as McIntosh, which they're still called a Mac in England.
Okay, but here in America with the hotter climate, not so well.
We were importing rubber overshoes and things from South America, and they just weren't going over because of, the instability. You have temperatures going from 80 and 90 degrees down to zero, so this difficulty with rubber continued to plague.
Okay, so how do we, I guess, fix this problem of instability? Because we see, you know, shoes here, and they look pretty good for being, you know, over 100 years old.
They do. Well, that's we can give credit to a couple people for that. One of them is Charles Goodyear in America. The other is Thomas Hancock over in England. Thomas Hancock was working with Charles McIntosh, and he was trying to develop a cure for this. Charles Goodyear actually stumbled into the Roxbury India Rubber Company, noticed something that had a valve on it, and he was an inventor himself, so he developed a better valve, took it back to him, and it might have been something like the valve on this life preserver. This is a later version of that. Goodyear from that point on became obsessed with finding a cure for rubber, and he basically spent 10 years of his life in poverty trying to develop a cure for this. And he did finally in 1839. And in 1844, almost simultaneously for the use of through the use of sulfur and heat combined with the rubber, found out that it created a change in the makeup of the rubber to give it permanent stability.
Okay, so that's kind of what we're seeing here in the soft clothing items.
Yeah, there's several things to note here. We go from this business of the rubber being unstable to something like this overshoe, which was made in the 1850s. It has the Goodyear patent markings on it. This was actually buried in the San Francisco area for well over 100 years.
Okay.
And it still has, that's the magic of vulcanization.
It's still really flexible.
It feels like a totes overshoe today, doesn't
it? Yeah. I have an overshoe actually just like that made out of modern rubber, and that's just as flexible as it.
It holds up pretty well. The enemies of rubber are oxygen, ozone, sunlight, things like that. So if it's exposed for long periods of time.
So that's kind of where you're seeing that this is brown on this side, but black on the other?
Well, that's good. Yeah, this is something a little different than when we refer to
soft
rubber.
So what's different about this?
This is hard rubber, which is a plastic-like material, but actually is not termed a plastic because it's totally natural. This is basically made with the same process as soft rubber, except they add more sulfur to the mixture.
Okay.
And then rather than pouring this in molds, this is made into rubber sheeting. Those rubber sheets are pressed into molds, heated up, and the vulcanization actually hardens the rubber. And yeah, you mentioned the fact that on the hard rubber, it starts out black, but if it's exposed to air, sunlight over a period of time, it's going to turn into this. Two things became very popular during the 1850s and 1860s, and that was the use of soft rubber for various applications, clothing applications, all types of air-filled things like life preservers and things like that, even waterbeds, believe it or not, and in the 1850s, and also a large number of hard rubber objects, which kind of revolutionized the way things were made and molded, because instead of being carved one at a time, we could mold them and, in effect, mass produce.
Yeah. So I know in some previous conversations you and I have had, you've mentioned this idea of recycled rubber, and I know recycling is really important today, they were doing it back then with this type of stuff?
Yeah, I think it's kind of funny when I see in the newspaper that's several years ago that they're recycling rubber and using it for various applications, and I had to kind of laugh because in the 1850s, the gentleman named Daniel Hayward developed a process up in Stoneham, Massachusetts, right outside of Boston. He had a big factory that actually recycled rubber. They took worn-out overshoes and boots and things like that, reprocessed them, and they were making buckets, the heels of boots and shoes, cuspidors and things like that out of recycled rubber.
So I know we're going to talk about some of this in some later episodes. Yeah. Really, there's just one more thing I want to talk about, and that's the name Goodyear. You know, everybody knows the name Goodyear.
Oh,
is this the same Goodyear where we're getting tires?
Not really, no. Charles Goodyear went on to help develop a large number of applications. He wrote a book that has hundreds of applications listed in it. He had an exhibition in the Great Exhibition, which was like a World's Fair in 1851 in Hyde Park, at the Crystal Palace. He was only one of three Americans to win top awards there. He had he had three rooms made entirely of hard rubber and rubber, the rugs, the walls, the furniture, balloons, musical instruments, combs and everything, and it cost him $30,000, which was a lot of money. He died in 1860.
Okay.
The Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company was founded in 1898, had nothing to do with any of these artifacts.
Okay.
It was named after Goodyear to honor his memory. Maybe quick mention of something, since it's on the title of the book, which we'll talk about in later episodes, but gutta percha, that name comes up a lot. And I think it's a lot of times it's a misnomer, but let's just keep in mind that in the 1850s, people took this gutta percha, which is a different type of latex entirely.
Yeah.
It can't be vulcanized like rubber can.
Okay.
But they were making rubber gutta percha shoes.
So similar
clothing
things,
items.
Just
yeah, but, soft items.
But
also,
they're not rubber.
They are not rubber per se, but they look and
similar.
Act like similar
okay.
to rubber. But
Well, today we've talked about hard rubber, we've talked about the soft India rubber objects, and we've talked about gutta percha. And I want to say thanks for being here today, Mike.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks to our patrons who have really made it possible for us to come out here to Pittsburgh to do this with Mike. Make sure if you want to see the upcoming episodes on the specific topics, you hit the subscribe button. And thanks from the Civil War Digital Digest. We'll catch you in a couple weeks.